So every show they've put on about this, they had like three. The YouTube scrubbed it, so I'm gonna record it.
Later in the decade, we'll see. But Joseph, that got scratched. So something's going on with the secret plan piece, and suddenly Mars has to be the completely dominant thing as far as news coverage goes.
Yeah, I find it very odd that we've had these let's go back into space deadlines. And if there's a pattern, as far as I can tell, Daniel, King George Herbert Walker Bush the first came out with that announcement, I think it was 1987 or 88, you know, we got to get back into space right away. And then Clinton's elected, and that's out the window.
Yeah.
Then we get Bush the Stupid elected, and we got to get back into space, you know, by such and such a date. Then along comes Obama, and that goes out the window.
Right.
And then Trump gets elected, and yeah, we got to get back into space. We've got to be on the moon by 2024, and we've got to be on Mars by some. And now it's out the window again with Biden in office. So I have to wonder, is this all just, you know, make-believe bipartisan theater, or is there a real tug of war going on here?
Mm-hmm.
And during this tug of war, the other thing that's been appreciably noticeable, as you're very well aware, is they've been coming out with all of these videos of UFOs and conferences, and they're pushing the ET meme, and it's all of a sudden Mars.
Yes.
So, you know, what's going on here? I have no idea, but I'm very suspicious of the pattern.
No question. And, well, so many of your books in the Giza Death Star book series are about the ancient technology, basically, so the message to me is that it seems, perhaps, that there are ruins that they've discovered, say on Mars, for example. And you said once they discovered those ruins, something would have happened. And that would have been the deep state would have taken a look at that and said, where are all the ancient documents on Earth? And said,
right. That's exactly what I think happened. You can't tell me that, you know, the face on Mars photo that Viking took, the very famous face, that was noticed by two NASA scientists, and they originally thought exactly what the narrative later came to be. Well, this is just a trick of light and shadow. But then they found another picture that was taken by Viking from a different sun angle and a different position, and it's still there. So it's not a trick of light and shadow. And at that point, you know, NASA starts putting out the narrative that, well, this is just a big trick of light and shadow. But they're, in doing so, and, you know, Hoagland laid all of this out in his numerous papers and books on the subject, that at this point, NASA is creating a narrative that pretty much went against its own scientists who've discovered the pictures. So what I'm suggesting is at that point they realize we have a genuine anomaly here, and that is going to require the deep state to take action and do some analysis if they're going to keep him from us. And I fully, firmly believe that as a part of that analysis, they're going to go back and look at ancient texts, you know, that Eric von Däniken, you know, people like that were in the popular view at that time, were talking about these areas. So they're going to do this. The other reason I think they're going to go back and look at ancient texts is we've got a UFO problem at the end of World War II, and they are interfering with our national defense bases, particularly our nuclear bases. You know, shutting down ICBMs or turning them on in the Soviet Union. Take your pick. And this is a genuine national security problem, but they are going to have to step in and take some sort of action. There's no way that they're going to ignore it. But we're not going to hear about it. So if they all of a sudden realize we've got the possibility of some ruins here on Mars, then the implication is that implies a technology. And if you go back and look at the ancient texts, you know, I put a lot of them in the book, The Cosmic War, or Giza Death Star destroyed. If you look at those ancient texts, it's very clear, if you read them with modern eyes, that they are talking about a technology. Very clear. I mean, in the Enuma Elish, you know, the so-called Babylonian creation epic, and I defy anybody to sit and read it and tell me that this is a creation epic. It's a war epic.
Right.
Pure and simple. You know, Quackademia likes to cover things up by giving it a name to make you think, oh, these people are just making all this up. It's Babylonian science fiction. No, it's not. Well, if you look at it, if you look at the Enuma Elish, you've got this big war between Marduk and Tiamat, and what's Tiamat fighting in? Well, she's fighting with biological weapons. Miscegenation, scorpion men, you know, all of this weird monsters that she's cooking up in her cauldrons.
Right.
So in other words, we're doing this today with modern genetics. We're creating these chimerical creatures. So it's not surprising that you would find it in a text related to a cosmic war, which you're going to have technology to fight. That's my point.
Yeah.
So these people are going to go back and look at these texts and realize that they've got a problem. And that's, I think, what we're going to do.
Right. So they're convinced that there's enough, but they probably already know at this point that there's enough there that they can reconstruct the idea of what took place.
Mm-hmm.
So they're taking then those ancient texts, the Epic of Gilgamesh or something of that nature,
mm-hmm.
as factual. They've changed their perspective and realized, oh, they're not mythical creations for academics. They are rather detailed histories.
Right. They're histories using language that the people recording them at the time had available. So again,
right.
the idea that they're going to talk about scorpion men, well, they don't have a word for miscegenation, but that's what they're talking about. They're talking about genetic engineering. So you kind of have to read these texts and bear in mind that you're either dealing with myth or you're dealing with people that are trying to record something very real in the language they have available. And that's what I think these people, you know, that would do this analysis actually did. And you know as well as I do, Daniel, that if you examine some of the photos coming from Mars recently, they are just chock full of things that should not be there.
No question.
Yeah.
And this is the kind of stuff that you pointed out. You did mention that Hoagland was very early on this.
Oh, yeah.
And one of the things that he got into were little complexes in Sidonia and that whole thing, which looked kind of like versions of Giza, but
mm-hmm.
up there.
Mm-hmm.
There were also the strange comments that Buzz Aldrin made in relation to some of the moons and how they had found things there that he couldn't kind of help himself and spilled out. So, and we've seen it echoed through movies like 2001 Space Odyssey and all that kind of thing. So the idea is there, it's out there in the culture as early as the 50s and 60s. When we look at it now, they've had years to study it in the last 50 with no public program except for, you know, Challenger shuttles and things of this nature, which are real fluff when you get into the space program. What do you think marks the 50-year gap of space development that the public hasn't seen in general? What's the kind of the core factor you think of is going on?
I think the core factor is this realization that human history is not the, and I think I mentioned this in the previous videos, human history is not this accidental history of humanity being hunting, doing their hunting and gathering, and then all of a sudden quitting and deciding to invent mathematics and astrology and animal domestication and start Sumer and Egypt, you know, out of the pure blue. Which is a narrative that never made sense.
Let's make a geometrically perfect pyramid, everyone.
And into time of it. Pinned in.
Hey, the Mayans didn't even have the wheels, supposedly.
Yeah, the Mayans didn't even have the wheel. You know, the poor thing.
Good luck throwing the stone. Brother.
Yeah, good luck throwing those stones. Yeah, go look at the chimneys and tell me these people didn't have the wheel. Come on. But yeah, this is the problem. They realize that history is not as academia would have it, or they had to invent that history real fast because, you know, at the end of World War II, you got a bunch of stuff flying around the sky that's going to grab attention and make people wonder. The other thing I think that's at the core of this is the technology aspect. Once you come to the conclusion that there was a high civilization and that it may have been interplanetary, and that it fought a war that was instead of destructive, a blown-up planet right here in our solar system. Once you come to those conclusions, then you would have to be totally irrational not to want to go out and get that technology, particularly at the height of the Cold War. Because, you know, if those records are true and that technology existed, or there may be some of it left, or enough information about it that we can piece it back together, we better get there before the dang risky.
Right.
You know, on and on we go.
Yes. Well, it's interesting because there's a CIA record that was declassified about placing agents inside the Harry Casey Foundation in the 60s to try to find out about what people knew about the Hall of Records under the Sphinx and if that was real, because Casey had said the Atlantic left their records there about this two-eyed man's stone, this crystal of the power station. So certainly there are things along, we know that they've searched for Noah's Ark, for example. So when they're engaged in this, in fact, a lot of the things that we see, it takes place very often in the Middle East. And we've also seen geopolitical situations there in the Caribbean around this. But they are engaged, in fact, in archaeological war.
By chance, somebody just happens to call, and he's going to come over.
I'm going to kill that spider.
It was like a bad
insertion of American forces into Iraq for the ostensible purpose of preventing some
enemy
from acquiring weapons of mass destruction. I think there was a certain truth because the way I look at it, part of the agenda, the hidden agenda there, was to go into that country and see if they could find any of those records, any of those Cuneiform tablets, any of those hidden technologies. That's what I think Saddam Hussein was looking for.
Oh, yeah.
So they trot out Colin Powell and, you know, give a speech about weapons of mass destruction. And most people are going to think, oh, A-bombs and chemical weapons and biological weapons. They're not going to be thinking in terms of an ancient technology or information about it. But that, I think, was definitely one of the hidden agendas. And the same thing with Mars.
Yes, absolutely. We know the looting of the Baghdad Museum was bizarre on young people.
Totally.
Because ordinarily, they never would have allowed that to happen.
No, never.
And they had complete control over those various things. And there was some confusion even about who was in there and looting. Right, at a certain point, people said, oh, you know, these people are dressed up as Americans. But you pointed out before that this is a little switch of uniform.
Yeah.
About who's in there. And the groups that were in there doing archaeology were, in fact,
French and German archaeological teams. And this is what makes me suspicious about that whole story. My take on it is that the archaeological teams themselves, themselves, which we, before we went into Iraq, we told the French and we told the Germans, get your people out of there. And they did. But here's the problem. The Baghdad Museum looting was reported first by their people in Germany, interestingly enough. And they're the ones that pointed out people, witnesses saw people in American uniforms going into the museum hauling out these crates. All right. Well, anybody can put on an American uniform. You know, the Germans have an intelligence service too. The French have an intelligence service too. And they certainly know what their uniforms look like.
Yeah.
So, you know, they can dress anybody up and, you know, give a false flag. But the thing that interested me is that the Baghdad Museum incident, when it was first reported, they said that people knew exactly where to go and exactly what they were looking for. Now, here's the problem. The problem is that the archaeological teams themselves would be keeping field reports of what they find. In other words, you know, you're on an archaeological dig and you find something interesting at such and such a depth level and such a location in your dig, and you write down the location of what you find, the depth at which it was found, a brief description of what was found, and so on and so forth. But no one, man, since the Baghdad Museum looting has ever made reference to the field catalogs of those archaeological teams doing the digs. No one.
It's really?
Yeah, it's a glaring omission.
Yeah.
Because if you're looking to recover this stuff, the first thing you're going to do is consult those field reports of the archaeological digs. And here's the problem. No one has. So I'm wondering if you even had access to them. Somebody did to go into the museum and haul that stuff out of there. And the finger of guilt points directly to the French and the German teams. They're the ones that would know what was in there. Absolutely.
Well, it's interesting because Hussein seemed almost obsessed with getting these archaeological digs.
Yeah.
And he had archaeological digs all over the place.
Yeah, he had them all over Iraq. And I think, you know, Hussein's not a stupid man. And he's going to be reading the same text that everybody else is reading and looking at things like the Epic of Minerva and say, well, that's a serious catalog inventory. Let's go find this stuff.
That's true. They found evidence of electroplating in Iraq.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Yeah.
The Baghdad battery.
The Baghdad battery, you know, and all of the other weird stuff that you see on those cylinder seals. Just before we came on air, someone sent me an email of an article that they found a cylinder seal, and I looked at this thing, and Daniel, I'm so gobsmacked by what's on the cylinder seal that I have to wonder if it's even real. Did somebody just make this up for a joke? Because what's depicted on the seal is a bomb. It looks like the Fat Man plutonium bomb that they dropped on Nagasaki.
Wow.
That's what it looks like.
Incredible.
And then next to it, there's this tree-like thing that could also be a mushroom cloud. And inside the mushroom part of the cloud, there are all these little arrows, like, you know, lightning bolts and stuff. And I thought, wow. You know, either someone's having a stupid joke here, or this cylinder seal exists, and it's depicting something that, you know, shouldn't be around in the
forest. I'd love to see this, by the way.
I'll blog about it probably next week, because, you know, it's one of those stories that you have to speculate.